I got
it. Hello, I'm here.
Hey.
Hello.
All right, well, then let's get started. Welcome everybody to our BPL panel on digital surveillance. Not all privacy is created equal. I'm really excited about our panelists today. We have Cassius Adair, who is an audio producer, writer, and researcher from Virginia, currently serving as a visiting assistant professor at NYU's Department of Media Culture and Communication, also a research fellow at Digital Research Ethics Collaboratory at University of Toronto, and a member of Precarity Lab at University of Michigan. And he's writing a book now about transgender people in the internet that I'm really excited about. We've got Albert Fox Kahn, who is a lawyer, technologist, writer, and interfaith activist, who is the founder and executive director of Surveillance Technology Oversight Project, or STOP. He's also a member of the Ashoka Fellowship Network, a member of the Engelberg Center on Innovation, Law, and Policy at NYU School of Law, and a columnist at the Gotham Gazette. And then we have Sarah T. Hamid, who is an abolitionist and organizer working in the Pacific Northwest. She leads the policing technology campaign at the Carceral Tech Resistance Network, co-founder of the Inside Outside Research Collaboration, the Prison Tech Research Group, and sits on the board of CARE Oregon. And in 2020, she helped create the hashtag 8 to Abolition campaign. And finally, she needs no introduction. She's maybe the most famous whistleblower in the world, who exposed war crimes in Iraq and Afghanistan and has endured the worst that our surveillance and security state has to offer, Chelsea Manning.
I also stream on Twitch. And I play video games, so.
Also very important. So I wanna start, whenever I talk with people about on this issue, there's like, it can be overwhelming for people. There's like a general sense of apathy about this. So I wanna go around and get everybody's like, what led them to this work and why they think the work opposing the surveillance state is so important. If anyone wants to start. Well, let's start with Cassius.
I'm usually first alphabetically, so I guess I will just take it. I got into this work through my experience just like as a trans person, encountering the ways that the state organizes itself to constrain what identities I can be, track other aspects of my identity, and also produce some aspects of my identity. And it became clear to me that the state wanted me to be a certain thing, and I had a real like desire, and I'm talking about the state as if it's a person here, but like just for the sake of metaphor, the state had a real desire for me to be a particular thing. And I found that really confusing. Like, why is it the case that I need to have a particular gender designation in order to do everyday acts of capital and governance, to have like a bank account, right? Doesn't the government really just want me to have a credit card because it's good that if I'm in debt, right? So just noticing the ways in which these multiple forms of tracking, both from the state and from corporate actors, seemed really incommensurate and illogical. And trying to answer the question of why that operates the way that it does in ways that sometimes seem like, oh, the state isn't doing a good enough job actually surveilling certain people, quote unquote, and it's doing an extra good job surveilling other people. What is the justification for that? And the more that I started to research that, the more that I understood the roots of that stuff in settler colonialism and anti-Blackness, that the ways that historically surveillance has been used is to further types of racial hierarchy and social segregation. So starting from my own experience, basically as a 21-year-old and being like, it's weird, I have to fill out these forms, to understanding the deep-rooted nature of surveillance and producing what I understand as my basic identity and sense of self, really transformed the way that I see myself and also the way that I see my work as fundamentally part of an ethical charge, I think, to undo these systems that, you know, contain us and capture us in economic senses and in social senses, and also just in a very individual and embodied way. So that's just my small link. And I also want to say I'm representing like a whole lab of people who have their own individual like aspects of this work, and all come to it for different reasons. But I think we share an ethical commitment to undermining the powers that constrain our ability to move and be and grow who we need to be.
Yeah, I love that. That's great. How about Sarah, want to go next?
Sure. Thank you so much for having me here. It's a pleasure, especially an honor to be on the panel with such amazing people. I feel like oftentimes this kind of a question requires that we kind of ground this political work in a story of trauma or what kind of inspired us to do this work. So in keeping with good faith, I guess I started high school when 9/11 happened. And so that was like a very formative event in my life, and very, very quickly, my family being Muslim, I saw what it meant to live in a society in which your neighbors can become antagonistic towards you overnight. And something very interesting happened to me because it was a universal sense of antagonism. It wasn't grounded in a political affiliation. It wasn't grounded in a particular kind of person, right? And so as I went through college and I saw the ways in which the techniques and technologies of the state was being mobilized both through the Bush administration and the Obama administration, it became really apparent that technology is a particular vector that goes through state power and reconciles state power in a particular way. And that's often through bipartisan support, or it's through liberal administrations. And the way in which that technology then has an effect on my life here in the United States or my family's life overseas can be devastating. And so I think organizers at CTRN, a lot of us come from similar backgrounds where we've experienced the way in which technology can be mobilized to enact horrific amounts of state violence and do so with a liberal or bipartisan veneer, and do so with absolute political impunity. And so CTRN organizers work on border technologies. And you can see that's mobilizing right now in front of us with the, with the Biden administration smart wall. CTRN organizers work on prison technologies, which are oftentimes positioned to be technologies for the benefit of incarcerated folks, when in reality they're extractive technologies or abusive or violent technologies. And me myself, I work with policing technologies. And so these are carceral technologies, and we articulate them as carceral technologies because they're technologies designed to do violence, whether or not they have commercial benefits that folks who aren't caught in the state's entrapment can benefit from.
Excellent. Albert or Chelsea?
Hey, I guess I'll go. The kind of work that I do now focuses mainly on sort of artificial intelligence and surveillance and, discussions about sort of like the implementation and the ethics of these kinds of things. A lot of that has to do with the work that I've done previously. Like, I used to be on the bad side, so to speak, I worked as an intelligence analyst, for the Department of Defense. And a lot of the work that I used to do, was at the intersection of surveillance and the collection of information, and the sorting of information, we weren't using machine learning at the time. It was much more like statistical, and it was much more like computational statistical analysis. But it had, you know, like it's directly connected to the sort of like machine learning for like, you know, the kind of machine learning that that Google uses, the kind of machine learning that Amazon uses, that a lot of large, you know, at Microsoft, as you know, Azure uses, in terms of like, you know, search engines, marketing data, Facebook, you know, ad data, and that kind of thing. And so, like the intersection and the overlap of sort of like this skill set with a lot of the different problems that we see, sort of like not just the online space, but also like in terms of like credit reporting and things like that. You know, so a lot of this just has to do with like familiarity and this like passion that I have to like say, oh, we, you know, these things really impact a lot of people, a lot of vulnerable populations all across the world, and are exploited and are used to exploit, you know, entire populations of people. And it's intentionally done that way. Sometimes it's not necessarily done. Sometimes it's not necessarily done 100% intentionally, but there's certainly a sort of like, oh, well, you know, these might not be feature, these bugs are actually features for us, you know, so we're not going to do anything about it. So that's sort of like where my background and familiarity with this, with these kinds of topics comes from, why I sort of like have a continual interest in this.
Well, I guess that leaves it for me. And let me just start by thank you, Joey, and the Brooklyn Public Library for having us. This is an amazing conversation to be a part of. And when I think of what got me into this space, I think back long before I founded my current organization, the Surveillance Technology Oversight Project, back to when I was 12. And two things happened that year. I went to my first protest against police violence here in New York City, and I built my first computer. And so ever since I was 12 years old, I've had these dual passions of civil rights work and interfaith community organizing, and then the passion about technology and how it reshaped the world and how it was remaking our communities. And you know, once I became a lawyer and was much more viewing the world through that legal lens, I kept coming back to the fact that these technologies were fundamentally redefining the social contract and augmenting all of the abuses that have defined American policing for as long as there's been an America, and looking at the ways that it really was quickly more and more looking like Black Mirror wasn't a cautionary tale, but a sneak preview of things that were just a few years away. And I think, you know, what's been amazing about doing this is that early on, a lot of the times people would ask, why do you care about this stuff? Why does it matter? But in more recent years, people are starting to get why it matters, precisely because of amazing whistleblowers like Chelsea, who have pulled back the curtain on the scale of surveillance that's unfolding. I mean, here in New York, one need look no further than, you know, yesterday's headlines about the fact that the NYPD was deploying a robotic dog. A $70,000 robotic dog without any public safety justification, but as this ever expanding rationale of omnipresent surveillance as somehow being a proxy for safety, when it's not about safety, it's about control. And so for me, when I think why it matters because, you know, unchecked surveillance puts communities of color at risk of police violence. It matters because it erodes civil rights, and it matters because democracy itself is incompatible with a state where we are always watched and always judged.
Thank you for all that. To build off of that, on some of the reasons you all got into this work, what have some of the biggest consequences been of the intrusion of surveillance in our, like, I'm following the story in Amazon in Alabama, and the way like Amazon has, you know, used different, like, you know, they have like heat maps in Whole Foods, and they have like, you know, infiltrated like different organizing efforts to try and union bust. but broadly, like, what have been some of the consequences of the invasion of surveillance technology in our workplaces, schools, neighborhoods, et cetera? What have been some of the worst consequences of that?
Well, since I went last time, why don't I kick off this round? When we look at police surveillance, there's a risk of false arrest, there's a risk of wrongful conviction, there's all those civil rights issues. But, you know, in the aftermath of the killings of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, so many others, let's be clear, when we're talking about police surveillance and the errors it leads to and the profiling it leads to, we're talking about the risk of a SWAT team at an innocent person's door. It's the risk of a knee to the neck. It's the risk of all the forms of violence and state-sanctioned violence that come that any time a person, particularly a person of color, is forced to interact with the police. And all too often, these costs are completely hidden because the scope of the surveillance state itself is hidden. You know, here in New York City, we used facial recognition more than 22,000 times in the last 3 years, more than 9,000 times last year alone. It has never once appeared in court. It's never once been up to the judge or the jury to evaluate its accuracy, its invasiveness, its bias, because it's part of this hidden element of policing that is basically left unchallenged. And so, you know, the harms are unfolding, but we can only document those rare cases, like the recent wrongful arrests of, you know, Mr. Smalls in New Jersey and two men in Detroit because of facial recognition. Those are the three cases we know about, but for every case we know about, there are probably hundreds, thousands of people who have seen their liberty threatened or taken because of these surveillance tools.
I guess I'll jump in here. So what I think is good, you know, particularly with like unionizing and, you know, I just want to sort of focus, like, focus in on like the Amazon, on the Amazon case in particular, because like it's in their interest, you know, it's like it's in large corporations and the state's interest to be able to use these tools without any oversight, without any sort of question whatsoever. So like the idea that the idea that they would like willingly allow people to come in, you know, like outside people or the public or the court system or anything like that to just like hand that over and volunteer that information and volunteer that scrutiny. It's just not in their institutional interest. Certainly there are people at Amazon or at Google that are like, you know, I do think that, you know, we have some ethical obligations and some duties to like consider the impact that, that these tools and these programs, have on people. There is sort of self-awareness of that, but like institutionally, there's no incentive or driver or institutional driver apart from, whatever leaks out or whatever is discovered by journalists or is, or whenever a program goes wrong and somebody is, you know, like some individual or group of people is actively harmed and there's sort of a backlash from this happening. So like those are the only instances in which a large corporation has an incentive, and they all have protections. You know, they have civil protections, they have liability protections, they have they lobby particularly local governments to be able to shield them from liability and scrutiny whenever it comes to like these sort of practices and things like that. And they also take advantage of the because these are mega corporations that have that exist in so many different jurisdictions. They can jurisdiction shop. You know, they can have, you know, like they're, you know, while something is happening in Bessemer, Alabama for Amazon, they're using, you know, Pinkerton detective, you know, they're using the Pinkerton agency, and they have offices in Colorado, you know, so like they have every incentive to double down and use this stuff and really fine tune these things without scrutiny, and they're going to continue to do so until there's like active public pushback. And that's not gonna come naturally, and they can't be expected to not continue to do these things.
Yeah. How do we end up where we are? If you want to stab at it, one of you, like how did a online marketplace like Amazon or like a search engine, like how did they get into surveillance tech? How did they start contracting with like ICE and Homeland Security? What led to that point? I don't know. What are the origins of the connections between these mega corporations and the intelligence agencies?
Well, let me just quickly note, we should remember that, you know, the internet itself is rooted in the Defense Department and the military industrial complex. So this is a novel form, but it's not a novel problem. And really, it has defined the technology for as long as it's existed.
All right. Maybe if you could break down some of the types of surveillance that are out there, what data is being collected and how it's being used and how people can protect themselves, if you have any insight into that.
I want to mark that question, and I do want to go there, but I wanted to also just speak a little bit to an earlier question about sort of what are the really bad things, what are the worst things. I'm based right now in Minneapolis, and I'm about three blocks from where George Floyd was murdered. And one thing that I've learned through the experience of living through these uprisings and also just like being a person who is watching the world, right? There's multiple layers of technological surveillance and interpersonal surveillance. And it's really important, I think, to not imagine that digital and technological surveillance emerges when digital technology becomes cheaper, right? The fact of policing is already a system of surveillance, and it has been for as long as we've had police. So in Minneapolis, for example, there were drones flying over protesters during the uprisings. And you think of drones as sort of the archetypal militaristic object that we in the continental United States tend to assume with things we do over there that shouldn't come here. At the same time, I don't think we should have those things anywhere, right? The fact that they don't belong on our streets is also, we have no ethical difference from other people's streets. There should be no drones surveilling anyone in any country. And at the same time, even if there were not those drones flying over us, there were also police shooting rubber bullets. That's not a digital technology, right? That's a simple act of state repression. And the fact is that one is built on top of the other. The permission to police a space on the ground is only mirrored, right, by the permission to police a space from the air. But if the former did not exist, the prior would not be extant either. So I just want to make sure that we're drawing a line between early forms of state power and surveillance. The idea of being policed in a public space is really important in the history of surveillance. Fingerprint technologies, keeping police files on people, photography, all of these technologies emerge in the late 19th century and early 20th century as part of racial anxiety about immigrants and about the Great Migration. And those are like the 19th century versions of drone surveillance and computer surveillance and tracking. So it's really important to me to see a through line in these technologies and to make sure that we're always rooted in the sort of grounded fact of racial exclusion and racial violence that sets the stage for later capitalistic, quote unquote, innovation and warmongering to accelerate, but not actually invent these formations.
I wanted to piggyback off of that a little bit. I think that it's an interesting question. It's actually one that gets asked a lot in terms of like, what are your horror stories, right? Like, what are the terrible things you've heard when you're working in this space? And one of the interesting things that both Albert and Cassius's comments bring up is the fact that those horror stories aren't what's new necessarily, right? These are very long-standing modes of state violence, modes of violence that have affected vulnerabilized communities. But one of the things that are new, or is new rather, is that all of us are now conscripted into that work because of these modes of innovation, right? Like recently there was the controversy over the Muslim prayer app, Muslim Pro, and it was a very like innocent app. Almost everyone in my family had it downloaded on their phone because it literally just told you what time of day you were supposed to pray. For a practicing Muslim, it's one of the most anodyne things, right? Because it happens 5 times a day, it changes every time, and you can't carry a piece of paper around with you. So it's so convenient, right? And I think one of the most horrific parts of that story isn't necessarily that it was used to spy on location data, but it was used to spy on location data for a very specific reason, to create a war machine and to train algorithms so that you can identify particular kinds of behavior of people, most of whom are overseas and are likely your family overseas, so that they can be easy targets for the military, which means that everybody who downloaded that app so that they can build their relationship with God 5 times a day essentially participated in the creation of a weapon to kill their family overseas. And I think that's the horrifying reality that more and more people need to confront, is that the way these commercial objects are sold to us, more and more, they're separated from their carceral counterparts. And we're not realizing that what we're doing when we use a face scanning app to unlock our phone and make facial recognition easier and easier is creating weapons that are gonna have those effects that Albert was describing. And I feel like I could tell you hundreds of terrible stories of police surveillance, but that's the story I really want to start telling people, is that right now we live in a moment where the most banal things like a Roomba or whatever it is, right, is being mobilized to kill people, which means that you and your life and your lifestyle and your consumer choices are being mobilized to kill and brutalize people.
Yeah, thanks for that. That's a very powerful connection that I'm glad you made.
I want to jump in a little bit because what I think is super interesting, and just as sort of like not just as somebody who like does this stuff regularly, but just as like a consumer, is like as like a or somebody who like interacts with like you know with my everyday life as somebody who like shops and like surfs the internet, right? How in the 19th century where a lot of these things came from, right? It was again, like, you know, very large corporations, like you think like Carnegie and the, you know, the Pinkerton agency, you know, the Pinkertons and whatnot. Then it sort of like became more and more the role of the state with, you know, where you have the Bureau of Investigation in the United States, at least, you know, you have, things started to be more, made into a government role. And now we're sort of like going back and everything's sort of like shifting towards being a private role. So it's like this large amorphous blob of surveillance technology that and the enhancement of that that's been happening both in the state and the private spaces you know, and they've been like, there's a symbiotic relationship that one doesn't exist without the other. One doesn't do this without the other. And their roles and how they're implemented have shifted over time, despite the fact that like the intentionality, the intentionality of these sort of things from an institutional perspective has remained largely the same.
I think that's such an important point. And one thing I wanted to bring up along those lines is antitrust. You know, when we think of the power of these companies and the way that they're able to weaponize our data against us and against our families, it speaks to the power that's come from really permitting these monopolies to grow and grow more entrenched. And it reminds me of the power wielded by the company towns of the, you know, early 1900s and late 1800s, where every aspect of government was being provided by these private corporations. And oftentimes there were, you know, these debates even until the mid 20th century about, well, it's private property. Do you have constitutional rights when the town square is privately owned, when the police officer is privately paid for, when every part of this has been privatized? And so you're speaking about corporate power instead of government power. And that synergy between the two is really dangerous. And I think that we wouldn't see the sort of data capture that we do from the private sector without that. And, you know, because of the way our legal system is set up, when they got more than 90 million people, close to 90 million users of that Muslim prayer app, when they got that data, they never had a warrant. They never had a subpoena. They never had a judge sign off on it, because they were buying data on the open market, because our legal system has this outdated idea that somehow if you're purchasing data from a company, you aren't using state power the same way as when you pry it from me directly. And I think that's something that we're going to have to address in the coming months, because if we don't, then all of those, you know, legal protections we have on paper, as questionable as they are right now with dealing with the government, are going to be absolutely useless when they can just buy everything they want from the companies that we're forced to use.
Thanks. Next question. Sarah, earlier in your introduction, you mentioned carceral technologies. I want to shift to that. You talked about how some of those technologies are sold as benefiting people who are incarcerated. And in our work in justice initiatives at BPL, we've been working to put content on these tablets that they have at the jails and prisons. That's like a private corporation that markets these tablets as like a benefit that people can, like, you know, get educational content and entertainment, etc. That's just an aside, though. I just wanted to ask you what new carceral technologies are being introduced, and how is the sort of how do you see the like defund the police and prison abolition movements as how do you see like these tech companies responding to those movements in like ways they want to shift surveillance and incarceration into the future?
I think a lot of what we're seeing now is very similar to what we saw during the Obama administration's 21st century policing initiative, where we saw technology companies respond not to calls for abolition or for reducing the scope and power of policing, but respond to this desire that is exemplified in liberal administrations to scientifically manage the police department and democratically manage a police department. And that's the call that technologists answer. Technologists follow problems. They follow state problems because usually private partnerships follow that. So funding follows that. And they position solutions to those problems. And oftentimes when the administration or when people who are in power, aren't approaching those problems from the lens of abolition, and they're approaching that problem from the lens of this was a mismanagement issue. This is something that we can fix at the level of better systems, better reforms. I think those are the incentive terms, I think, for technologists to jump in and offer something like body cameras, right? Which organizers from the beginning were extremely cognizant versus simply, it's an outward facing camera. This is a surveillance tool. It's not even pointing at police, right? But the Obama administration was very, very eager. And you saw this in a lot of city level conversations around things like body cameras, because oftentimes you can see how the needs of vulnerabilized communities get leveraged for meeting these particular business incentives, right? So people were saying things when they were Axon was saying things when they were marketing body cameras, that this is something that families of people who are brutalized by the police, they're always asking for the body camera footage, right? So this is clearly something that answers the call for police abolition without acknowledging the fact that that was literally the last minutes that their loved one was alive. So obviously they want the footage, right? There's nothing to do with whether or not body cameras solve police reform issues. It has to do with the fact that that was the moment that their loved one died, that those were the last few minutes of them on earth. So obviously they want the footage. So I feel like kind of to bring it back, the response that technologists have, the response that these corporate interests have, is to answer that need to reform and to manage and to offer solutions that are meant to solve very, very small, precise problems, and to solve those problems long enough that they're financially viable, but it doesn't even matter if they fundamentally solve those problems or shift those conditions. So they're not responding to defund the police because they're not interested in defund the police. Their bottom line relies on private public partnerships that allow them to create more and more commercial goods for police departments.
Right. I'm just going to jump in on this a little bit, because what I think is interesting is that when we're talking about the carceral sort of system, what I think is fascinating fascinating isn't really the word, but like one of the things that I focus on because it doesn't get focused in on, I feel like enough, is that once somebody is like processed into the system, they're essentially commodified by the prison industrial complex. So both by the state and by sort of private corporations, that you've essentially commodified somebody as a part of their quote unquote rehabilitative or their carceral sort of process. Like from the second that you go into a jail or a prison or even just court supervision, court supervision, like there's a whole huge industry of monitoring people, who are under court supervision. Think of ankle bracelets, think of, all of the various surveillance tools and methods in terms of like monitoring people and their daily activities that often go awry, and how you have to, and how those people are essentially turned into, and you'll often hear people in this industry describe them as customers, like the people who are ordered into, into parole or into probation will often be referred to as customers by these companies that say, oh, you have to do this. And plus it's a monopoly. So you either go to jail, stay in jail, or you pay exorbitant fees to a company, and it is only one company. You don't have you don't have the consumer choice. You don't get to choose like which ankle bracelet company you get to use. Like that is that you have to pay for depending on your jurisdiction. you know, and then if you are in jail, then like commissaries and like, where are you getting your food? And like, what phone company that you have to use, like in order, and you're only able to like use telephones, you know, that cost exorbitant amount fees to be able to use. Visitation has even been commodified in some states and jurisdictions, because you know, in order to see your family, they've essentially said, oh, okay. Like, you know, we're not going to put you in a room with your family. We're going to instead have a screen that requires electronics. And then we can charge you for having people who've come in and physically visit you. And it's like, and every single time it's like, is spoken of as like, oh, you know, it's better for security, you know, for safety and security. It's better for rehabilitative purposes or whatever. Really, it's about extracting from it's transforming a person and the carceral sort of process of an individual and a group of people into sort of like a wealth extraction program.
Yeah, and I just want to say something very quickly, which is that this is one of the places where the conversations around carceral logics bleed into so many different institutions of life. So in the pedagogical space, if you're an educator right now, you're noticing very similar types of logics, like buy this app so that your kid can go to Zoom school, the surveillance technology that's inherent in anti-cheating types of apps. There's a policing mentality in quotidian spaces that we think of as supportive or affirming spaces. So it's part of sort of what Sarah was talking about the mobilization and the militarization of affective connection, of desire to be in a community, of things we think of as positive goods in society, turned into not just commodities, but actually quite violent data collection and extractive mechanisms. And I don't mean to equate students and incarcerated people, because I know that those are different conversations. But in terms of the way that those logics extend to populations that we're not necessarily thinking of as carceral, but in fact are undergoing carceral logics and carceral subjection, I just think it's really important to like watch where the same logics pop up in spaces that apply to people who are not overtly criminalized, but might be proto-criminalized or pseudo-criminalized.
I think that's such an important connection. I think looking at the way a lot of the surveillance vendors have pivoted over the last year in response to COVID-19 is so telling, because whatever they sell, they always say that their surveillance is the solution to your problem. When before COVID, they were saying that these intrusive school surveillance platforms were the way to stop a school shooter. How? They never really had a good case for it. But just if you watch everyone record everything, track location, somehow that will have this amorphous benefit. And when that stopped being a good sales pitch, they repositioned those same student tracking apps as now a way to track exposure notification, to do contact tracing. And you know, we see the same dynamic repeating in all of these different spaces where the harms are so clear, where people are being so deeply injured, where they're being tracked in these ways that are highly destructive, where it's you know, costing them their liberty, where it's having huge mental health impacts, where it's hugely costly and all these things. But the benefits never actually materialize. And that's why it's so maddening when people frame this as a question about, well, it's values versus safety, or it's values versus health. No. It's garbage versus, you know, our having actual civil rights. It's garbage tech, or having, you know, privacy. It's we don't have to choose, because, you know, look at the remote proctoring software. If you go on TikTok, you will find so many videos of kids showing step by step how they're getting past the remote proctoring software. And this is a software that puts a video camera in their bedroom. It is giving the most invasive look you could imagine into someone's home in their private space. In some cases, forcing people to take high stakes tests in the bathroom because it's the only place that meets the isolation requirements for the test. And you know, then at the same time, you have kids who are able to easily avoid it. So it's not actually giving us fairer testing, but it is giving us lots of traumatized test takers. And so I think this is something we always have to push back when the vendors come to us and say that this is the solution. We have to, before we get to the trade-offs, we have to ask that upfront question, are you actually doing anything to help? Because I assure you, most of the time, the answer is no. Oh, you're on mute, Joey.
My bad, sorry. So yeah, let's shift into like what we can do, because this is like a lot, you know, this I'm sure is, you know, overwhelming to think that, you know, our participation in any digital life is creating the infrastructure for like our, you know, the carceral state, the military industrial complex, et cetera. Should we think about it as a privacy issue? Should we think of it as a issue of democratizing the internet and digital technologies, having more public control over those spaces? What movements do you see that are happening now that you are excited about? And what sort of pushes do you see coming in opposition to the surveillance state that you're skeptical of?
All right. If nobody has anything, I have a lot I want to say here. you know, one of the things that I think to sort of like organize and push back against the stuff that we saw in the last, you know, 4 or 5 years, you know, like I've been giving these talks about like, you know, like it's the responsibility of technologists who design and develop and create a lot of these products to establish the ethical standard, to like do the prep work, to like do the research, like to really like plot out the where the pitfalls of a particular technology are, and whether or not, you know, a particular technology should even be designed, developed, or implemented, and that a lot of this this responsibility is actually on is ultimately not on the hands of the consumer and the public, but, you know, at the very beginning of the stuff is on the people who design and develop these things, you know, and that technologists, you know, people who have the knowledge to like do machine learning algorithms, to design camera systems, who like fully understand the information flow and how that information gets sorted and stored and whatnot, like have the responsibility to like understand how much these technologies impact people, right? So that it's sort of like the very first line of defense, you know, against the stuff are the people who develop the stuff. But you know, as much as I want to say like, oh, this is where we can do a lot of good things, this is even the most basic attempts at doing this have essentially been crushed vehemently in the last year alone. I think of so many people, not you know, obviously there's been two high profile firings and the sort of dismantling of the ethical AI sector of Google. This is not the only, this is obviously the most high profile of this, you know, because like Google, I think, and I think Google initially thought like they could like, you know, like, oh yes, you know, like, we, you know, like this is a good thing. Like this is a good program. So they hired really good people. Some of the best, you know, some of the best and smartest people I know, not just the two people who are fired, some highly respected people in this field. And, you know, they started to do this. They started to like do this analysis, to like do this work, to do this advising. And, it is just completely like, I think that they just decided to toss the whole idea aside because like, they're like, oh yeah, actually JK, you know, just kidding. We didn't, you know, like we like wanted to appear to be, to have like an ethical AI program. We didn't want to actually do this. And so I think that's one of the things that I've been finding alarming is that I have been advocating for people to do certain things, you know, in the technology space. And whenever, almost every single time that people have been doing this stuff, it has led to the companies or the government, essentially like firing people and, you know, like getting rid of entire offices and entire sections and entire departments and even shutting down entire programs only to like reinitiate the program with an entirely new staff. So not, I want to be optimistic and I do think it's valuable work, but I also think that, and I think this is the most effective way of doing this, but it's just astounding. I've been quite frankly a bit surprised at how effective the put downs of these efforts by well-meaning, well-intentioned and highly qualified experts have had.
I think when we look at the national landscape, it's kind of bleak for all of the reasons Chelsea mentioned. And also when you look at the federal legislative landscape, we're debating Section 215 of the Patriot Act, you know, for nearly 20 years ago. We're still debating it today. We're debating Section 230. You know, a lot of these debates seem stuck in place, but at the same time, in the last couple of years, we've seen more than a dozen cities and one state outlaw facial recognition used by government. We saw one city even go further and ban a lot of private sector facial recognition. We've seen bans on license plate readers, bans on types of other biometric surveillance. We've seen this growing movement and momentum at the city and state level. And so one of the things I always like to advocate is to stay local and to stay vocal, because I think as we continue to see success in local fights, it will set a national standard that then will enable legislation and other actions nationally to push back on things like facial recognition. And I think that, you know, especially here in New York, you know, having just, you know, a few people committed to pushing a piece of legislation through, to pushing a policy through, that can have such a huge impact. Calling up your council member every day, those sorts of things. You have so much power right now to shape the way our city is spied on, the way that we are tracked. And it's, you know, really one of the few places where I feel like we all have that sense of agency. We all have that sense of power. And so I think one easy thing I will shamelessly plug, because the deadline is today, is people can go to postact.org, postact.org. And this is the website where the NYPD is receiving comments on all the surveillance tools that we use across the city, all the ways that they are spying on New Yorkers. And they are in a comment period right now, which is where they are required to review all the comments that are submitted between now and the end of the day. And if people submit those comments and the NYPD disregards them, there's potential to sue. There's potential to hold them accountable. And so it is one of those levers of power that people have to try to push back against the omnipresent surveillance.
I can jump in. I think both of these ethicists in state legislation, local level legislation, are important. I think what I'd like to contribute to that conversation is that one of the things that both of these models has a tendency towards is individualizing this problem, right? Individual ethicists, individual voices. And we arrived at this technological present through collective action. And that's the only thing that's going to be able to affect change here. That requires organizing, that requires creating collective power and responding. Somebody told me something yesterday. They said that if the cloud were a country, it would be the sixth largest energy consumer in the world. That means that our technological present is just no longer ecologically sustainable. We just can't. There's no other answer. We just cannot, right? And that's going to require a collective response. That's going to require all of us moving against this way of living in a way that, quite frankly, is not incentivized by our technological present. Our technological present wants to atomize us. It wants us to think of ourselves as an individual being, alone and separate on one end of a Zoom call, right? But that's not where we are. And that's not what's going to be able to shake things up. So I'd always advise, as we're moving in this space, to start building power with people, as many people as you can, start building those chains, because ultimately the thing that we're confronting is so massive, but it became massive because a lot of the people built those chains, and we can too.
I think that's just such a beautiful way to put that. And I want to offer an image from where I sit in Minneapolis, which is that after the murder of George Floyd, activists blocked off a square, which is the intersection of 38th and Chicago, where that killing happened, and basically used concrete roadblocks to establish a space where no other cars could drive in, and created a sort of an ad hoc common space where police vehicles couldn't come through during the winter. They kind of moved some of the barriers so that the snow could get plowed out of the way, but where citizens really did have a lot of jurisdiction. And the city council keeps wanting to open up the intersection and the people keep saying no. And those are the same group of activists that are spreading information about how to kill facial recognition in the city of Minneapolis, for example. There's an extreme confluence between the attention to digital surveillance and the making of a place on the ground where people are meeting each other, handing out coats, handing out free food. And I think that sometimes we think of activism as one or the other. And increasingly I see peer education about how these things are interlocked. So I see the folks who are occupying George Floyd Square and giving out bags of food and mittens to people also using Instagram to be like, hey, call your city rep. Like, we need to ban facial recognition software in order to continue to live freely. So I think that there's like something is really possible happening on the ground. And there's a lot of education happening in physical space that is, I mean, it's harder to surveil. It's a lot easier to put up a concrete roadblock than it is to stop using digital technology entirely. And I think there's some real, there's real potential about those connections and how live they can be that does excite me, that does give me optimism. And I'm like, I just couldn't be more pleased that is part of the legacy of the summer's uprisings, is the connecting of the digital and the sort of like the physical analog.
Yeah. And you know, just to sort of like hop on that, I wanted to just point out, like, you know, that the connection between like education and the spread of information and mutual aid and sort of like, you know, especially like, I mean, like I saw it here in Brooklyn and in Lower Manhattan in the summer of last year, you know, like where you would find like, you know, the spreading of information and, you know, mixing in with like, you know, the spread of like hand sanitizer and masks and things like that. So like, you know, like the these things do overlap. And this was a widespread phenomenon that was happening. You know, it's just like, one of the things that worries me is that, you know, everybody knows that there's a problem at this point. It's not like an education problem. It's like everybody is aware of the fact that we live in a surveillance hell. You know, it's like what can we do to like push back and actually do things? And I think one of the things I just that I like consistently tell people is that, you know, is that the first thing that you have to do is like get out of this mindset, this framework that somebody else is going to fix it. That like, you know, it's the bystander problem. You know, it's sort of the expectation that there's a bad thing that's happening. Somebody is going to do something about it. Somebody's going to fix it. And, you know, the reality is that only through collective action, only through a worldwide dialogue, only through worldwide large scale collective action are we going to be able to really push back against this. And it's not as sexy as saying like, oh yeah, we can shuffle a couple offices because it's like really hard. It sounds really hard, but you know, it does start at a small level. That's my two cents.
I think that's really beautiful. And one of the things I think, like in that narrative of what is the legacy or what's the inheritance of the Summers Uprising, one of the things that I've also noticed is a shift towards how folks understand digital security, right? That being a collective obligation. That's been very interesting to me, right? Like, don't show up to an action with your phone, not because it puts you at risk, but because it puts your comrade at risk. Right. Or like in the Portland context over the summer, we saw a lot of instances and later of right-wing doxing, right? And doxing became a collective problem because the labor it takes to scrub someone's identity offline, like that's like time. And that takes all of us coming together and committing to each other's safety to make that happen, right? So to understand digital safety as an obligation that we have on each other is also one of those shifts that I saw and increasingly getting excited by, because it's no longer that surveillance tech victimizes you as an individual. It victimizes your whole entire network. And so you need to start thinking about safety that way. I think COVID and the COVID vaccine did a lot to help shape that analytic, right? Because you take that vaccine to help your grandma. So you start to understand how inoculation works differently.
Great. So it's 5. So we're going to transition into the Q&A. One of the Q&As on the live chat is, can you talk a little bit about the ways vulnerable communities and or activists have been surveyed and infiltrated in pre-internet times? And what are the continuities and differences between then and now?
Happy to talk a bit about this. I mean, as long as we've had any technology, we have used it to spy on over-policed and marginalized communities. Here in New York, we had lantern laws even before the United States was founded. This was using the technology of the time to make sure that anytime anyone who was Black or Indigenous left their household, that they had to have this beacon on them so they could be tracked by the white colonists. So they could, if they ever congregated together, they could be seen. You know, flash forward to the early 20th century and you saw, you know, the analog technologies for, you know, everything from, you know, early wiretaps and inspection of the mail. And it's really the same power dynamic over and over again. And throughout, we've also seen, you know, confidential informants, undercover officers, all the human intelligence techniques that are still in use very much to this day, also as part of the same dynamic. So the technologies are definitely changing and they make the surveillance cheaper and easier to scale, but they don't actually change the ways that it's weaponized or the targets it's weaponized against.
Yeah, I just want to name drop one of the scholars who works on this a lot, who is named Simone Brown, which is, I think that's where you're getting the lantern laws anecdote. Maybe that's just something that people know besides from reading it. But Simone Brown's book is really fantastic on the history of anti-Blackness and surveillance technology, you know, starting really at these sort of originary moments in the sort of 1619 moment, and thinking about visuality, surveillance, and technology as organized around a project of global and US specific anti-Blackness. I also wanted to shout out my friend Yvonne Char Lopez's work. He's working on a project to trace early electronic surveillance on the US-Mexico border. and the connection between electronic fencing and digitization and what we've talked about in this panel is smart fencing. And just tracing the long genealogy of those things and thinking about how borderization as a war project is now reflected in the very logics of the desire to wire the border as a sort of like less physical form of building the wall. So those are just two small examples, but again, sort of to Albert's point, like the US racial state is very invested in this work and in fact designs and organizes and mobilizes technologies, whatever those technologies are, around the same goal, which is why it's so important not to just tackle, oh, this technology is bad, but the same way that prison abolition is also a way of thinking, that anti-surveillance must be kind of a way of thinking ethically in community.
Great. So what are, what's everyone's thoughts about policing on the internet specifically, like deplatforming, FOSTA, SESTA, it's like, et cetera, like how should we engage with the internet terrain as a political space?
I think I'm going to jump in here. So whenever we start to talk about the internet space, it often surrounds copyright, I find, so like the Digital Millennium Copyright Act of I think 1998 or whatever, essentially, it changed the landscape of internet of like downloading music on the internet, right? That's how it started, right? But one of the things that we've seen is that we've seen DMCA and sort of like the lack of like oversight of, but also the like heavy insistence that DMCA be enforced by companies being used as like ways of having streams taken down or videos taken down that have absolutely, where the intention is to take down a particular video as like a censorship thing, or take down a particular streamer or whatever. Especially in the quarantine, now that we've shifted more and more into the digital space in terms of like, sharing of information and sharing of data, using things that would typically be very, very minute and not a big deal, and that would clearly be covered under fair use, and the benefit of the doubt being put by an algorithm, not even a human being, into we're going to take this down, and then the harm being caused until you go through the painful process of proving that it's covered under fair use, by which time the topic or the person is the data has already been taken down. So like whenever it comes to like FOSTA and SESTA, it's very much the same sort of thing, it's obviously targeting sex workers and sex work and like the sort of back page, is like used to take down Backpage, where initially it's used as a way, wrongfully in my opinion, because I think sex work is work, but that it starts off with like sex work and like under the rubric of like protecting against like human trafficking or whatever, which is already illegal, and is already covered under the existing legal process. But like saying that like, oh, in order to like prevent this from happening, what we need to do is we need to take down websites that allow for that essentially allow sex workers to exchange information with clients safely and easily and conveniently. And now that sort of like being shifted to like maybe potentially go after pornographers or after organizations that protect sex workers, like the Sex Workers Outreach Project and whatnot, and their websites and whatnot. So these the digital laws are being used very ham-fistedly, and I think that there is a sort of like intentionality in terms of like the abuse of DMCA, the abuse of FOSTA FESTA, FOSTA SESTA, and yeah, so you know, and I think that the, I think that these are going to become only more salient as we become more digital, you know, and we exist more and more as this consumer of energy on the global stage.
I just want to say I'm a teacher, and my favorite thing to do is give assigned readings. And my assigned reading for this question would be a book called Tumblr Porn by AC Valens. It's a really tiny book. And it's written in such a conversational style, and yet it's so deeply well-researched. It really is wonderful at connecting this conversation about FOSTA SESTA to larger issues of deplatforming, and even connecting that to the way that digital communities police one another, and to what extent that is an integration of digital policing and police state logics, and to what extent that is just a way to find accountability in a world that has so little accountability for marginalized people. I think this book is so fantastic. The author is like 25. It makes me so mad. So please go read the book Tumblr Porn if you're interested in these topics.
Yeah, I'll just vouch for this this book as well. It's really good.
I think that we definitely have the problem that Chelsea mentioned about ham-fisted enforcement, but I think part of the problem is the laws themselves are written so broadly with such punitive sanctions. I'm thinking of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act and you know the life of Aaron Schwartz, who, for people who haven't read about his just heartbreaking story, here's someone who is trying to broaden the access that people have to knowledge using files from JSTOR, a database that now is largely open to the public. And he was facing years in prison, and he is no longer with us because of the prosecution there. And you know, we keep seeing this dynamic with federal laws around the around computers, that you know, you have these draconian sanctions that are dealing with a problem that is already addressed by existing laws. We already had laws on the book that addressed what happens if you steal someone's property. We already have laws on the books that deal with human trafficking. We already have these things, but yet we hear these pretexts for even more aggressive and abusive prison terms. And it's just horrifying how deadly the consequences can be. And especially with FOSTA SESTA and the Earn It Act, which is being pursued now, and other laws designed at, you know, attacking sex work, it really is this, it is something that is devastating for so many people. And it's something which we are only inflicting upon ourselves as a country.
Great. Let's see. Could you talk a bit about the outward and latent purpose of automating welfare services, like applying for benefits?
I'll just do a quick plug for the work of Meredith Whitaker at AI Now in regards to Project Midas in Michigan, where you know, tens of thousands of people were wrongly accused of benefits fraud, forced into bankruptcy, even worse, by using AI to monitor for fraud that wasn't happening. And this is something where a lot of people are facing really dire consequences.
Can Sarah or others talk more about the environmental impact of the cloud and surveillance tech?
So this is something that I'm new in thinking about, because we've been working in coalition with Indigenous organizers who have a theory of or a criticism of privacy, a criticism of enclosure, and a criticism of consumption that we can all learn a lot from. And I've been learning about not just the amount of water that digital infrastructure requires, not just the amount of electricity that digital infrastructure requires, the rare earth minerals and mining and lithium and all of these industries that have extremely deep rooted histories in colonialism and extraction, that something as mundane as your phone relies on to exist, both in terms of scale, economies of scale, but also in terms of just the minerals that go into producing it. And so I feel like this is a conversation that I would love to learn more about, and I'm continuing to learn more about, but it's absolutely fundamental because a lot of things about our digital present we're just not aware of. And one of those is things like conflict minerals.
Yeah, I have some familiarity in this area one of the things that I've been sort of like focused in on more stable and environmentally friendly sort of like technologies is like, the amount of processing power that like the amount of like energy usage in terms of like cooling, graphical processing units for video games or machine learning, the amount of coolant required to like keep servers like running in large scale facilities and whatnot, extraction and the process in terms of like producing one chip, you know, is like the one little chip in your phone, like it uses so many different like elements and subcomponents from all over the world, and just the transportation of that alone, just the, you know, like not even just the extraction of it, but like the transportation of it alone, like the amount of fossil fuel usage, the amount of energy usage, like it's just astronomical. And so like one, you know, like in terms of like, you know, like one of the things that I've been sort of like encouraging people in doing is like thinking about, okay, how do we use technologies, or how do we use things that we already have, you know, like how do we turn older iPhones into, you know, something that can be, you know, that way we're not having to like generate something new. How do we use a Raspberry Pi to like, which is, you know, doesn't use a lot of energy consumption, already exists as sort of like an existing project. How do we turn that into a way in which, you know, a small organization can actually have their entire, you know, their entire file server, or their, you know, that way they're not having to host something on the cloud. How, you know, can we get this, you know, can we use like 5 watts instead of 500,000, you know, like the amount of like, you know, it's just sort of like sustainability. I think that there's a lot of opportunities in terms of like sustainable alternatives, environmentally friendly alternatives, extraction, you know, things that don't require exist, you know, that don't require more extraction, things that, you know, cause like, unfortunately, you know, there's no real way of obtaining this stuff, in a sustainable manner, but like the stuff that we've already taken out of the ground, that we've already extracted from, you know, vulnerable, you know, from equatorial regions of the global South, how can we use what we've already taken out of those places and reuse it, you know, in going forward, you know, and this is directly tied to the surveillance apparatus, because like all this data collection is just a huge amount, you know, requires a huge amount of energy. That was just what I wanted to say.
Yeah. And I just wanted to just really quick, the question about welfare automation, I had to look up the scholar's name because I realized it had changed recently, because trans people love to do digital research and also change their names in the middle of their academic careers. And I just like think that's awesome, but I wanted to make sure I got the right name. I would send anybody curious about that question to someone named Yvonne Bramble at University of Maryland College Park, who's working on government computer systems and Marxist geography, especially around the San Francisco Bay Area, alongside the rise of the welfare queen as a figure, as sort of like a racialized and feminized figure, who's also sort of understood as being technologically savvy, right? Kind of like a hacker figure of the system. So Yvonne Bramble at University of Maryland is such a genius about this stuff.
Excellent, thanks for that recommendation. Next question. Surveillance and security are terms used to describe the same concept, but how do we separate the two while pushing back against these technologies? And I guess just thinking again how these technologies are sold as keeping us safe, and you know, how do you think about that?
I mean, framing is so important, language is so important, and making sure that we never talk about, you know, a home security system, it's a home spying system, it's a home surveillance system, trying to recontextualize a lot of it and trying to redefine the terminology, right? Because this is just a false premise. It's empirically false. These systems don't work. They don't actually make us safer, and they make a lot of people less safe. And I think it's just a part of our language that we have to be very thoughtful and proactive about redefining and to make it clear that this technology is harmful.
One of the things I wanted to bring up that hasn't come up yet is the intersection of like the surveillance apparatus and sort of like the usage of app data and the gig economy, which is like it's an area that I've been focusing more research into personally, which is like this idea of like, oh, you know, how the Lyft driver or the DoorDash delivery person, what their day-to-day life is like in terms and like how they're surveilled from, you know, not just on their sort of like on time whenever they're actually doing stuff, but in their off time too, like in terms of like they're, you know, they're constantly using their app, but you know, and they're constantly have their location, you know, it's not like they're turning off their locational data the second that they stop doing their work, you know, and obviously the time scales in which they're working and stuff. And the amount of money that's being extracted out of them because they're not considered employees, they're considered subcontractors, you know, so I don't have a lot of information about this, but I think it's definitely one of the newer areas of like, extraordinary amounts of surveillance of people is occurring in a relatively new digital space that frankly there isn't a lot of research in. At least I haven't done enough.
I hadn't even thought of, you know, specifically the gig economy and surveillance and the shift to definitely something. If anybody out there is a researcher, wants to research that. Next question. How can we balance the ability of digital platforms to connect activists and give a voice to marginalized groups with those same platforms' shortcomings in terms of privacy, complicity, and state and corporate power?
You don't need an app to connect with people. You can literally just turn to the person next to you. I know that's more complicated in COVID times, but I'm told a vaccine is on its way. You don't need, like, before COVID, our most, like, in terms of expenditures as a community organization, our most money was spent on whiteboard sheets and big fat markers, right? Like, that is the tool of organizers. So it is alluring to want to innovate our way to a better world, but I promise that you don't need those things. You can build connection by having, you know, just like sharing space with somebody, sharing bread with somebody, very, very basic human things, and those things can build human connection, and you don't need metrics and you don't need an app to do it.
Thank you. There's one that we haven't gotten to. On the topic of surveillance in school, could you speak a bit more on this and how it plays into the modern school to prison pipeline?
Happy to talk about this. We've done a couple reports on this topic, and you know, surveillance is increasingly one of the key drivers of the school to prison pipeline. And it's also redefining what counts as school spaces and private spaces. We've seen young children who have the police called to their homes because they have a toy gun visible in the remote classroom, and they're accused of bringing a firearm onto school grounds. Like they can't, they were given no private spaces left at this point. We see an increase in automated tracking of student behavior using predictive analytics to try to determine who is at risk of committing violence, who is at risk of mental health disorders. And it's all pseudoscience. None of it works. And you see a lot of racialized algorithms then leading to increased calls to ACS and to child services, protective services, because of the outputs from these algorithms. And so it really, especially right now, while so many kids are in hybrid or remote learning environments, this mass surveillance, including the ability to have real-time analytics about what a kid is searching for on that school-provided tablet to make an assessment of who they are based off of their search history, that is deeply disturbing. And it's also something that is likely not to go away as soon as the COVID crisis is over. And we certainly see the same with the contact tracing apps and other exposure notification systems that schools use that can track students basically perpetually.
Finally, this is a library program, and you've already mentioned some books, but I want to get all of your book recommendations on this topic, or any others if you have.
I could literally do this for 7 hours. I've already dropped a lot of my favorite ones. Toby Beecham has a book out on transgender studies and surveillance studies that I think is really good. The book Captive Genders, which is a anthology, is really wonderful. That one's really, really, really legit. I think there's just trans people right now, and I don't want to say that trans people are all good. There's definitely trans people who work for the security state. That's part of what my research is showing. But I think that there is an effort within trans communities to really reckon with the way that digital surveillance is part of our identity formation and the ways that we talk to one another. And also that our bodies set off sensors all the time, right? We're always the sensor anomaly. So what does that mean? How do we talk about that? So I would go to trans studies, and I think Captive Genders would be the place where I would start.
I'm going to jump in and just say, as a contributing writer to Captive Genders, I have an entire section of that book that I contributed to. I highly recommend that book as well. But also, two books that really come to mind in this area are Radley Balko's. I forget the name, but Radley A. R-A-D-L-E-Y, Balko, B-A-L-K-O, has a book about the rise of the police, of the militarization of the police state. So it's something along those lines. I think it's the, I can Google it, my recommendation of books in terms of how we came to have a militarized domestic police apparatus, at least in the context of the United States, and to a certain extent Europe. And another book that I would highly recommend, just jumping off of Captive Genders, is the work the I mean any of the works by Dean Spade, from the He's a professor of law at the at the Seattle law school. So the work that he does in particular focuses in on the carceral apparatus, immigration, and starts off with like sort of like trans people and intersectionality, but like branches out into the entire military industrial prison industrial complex, police industrial complex, military industrial complex, uses that as sort of like a way of analyzing things like how that's sort of like systematized, through the lens of like a trans people in particular.
I like to think of specific domains oftentimes. I think, and because most of my work is around policing tech, I think my two recommendations would be Brendan McCabe's book, Pacifying the Homeland, and a recent book, Prison by Any Other Name. I think that you can start to see how different technological histories unfold in both of these. And then since you are a library, Dan Green has a book coming out soon called, I think it's called Promise of Hope. And it's about libraries and as a physical space and how technological cultures infiltrate libraries and the effect it has on communities, especially houseless communities that are really reliant on libraries. And so I think that might be something that y'all would enjoy.
I want to suggest Ruha Benjamin's Race After Technology, The Rise of Big Data Policing by Andrew Ferguson is also a really good book, and then Shoshana Zuboff's Surveillance Capitalism as well.
Thank you all so much. I'm not used to facilitating these things, so thanks for bearing with me. And I've learned a lot. I'm sure everyone who's watched has learned a lot. And hope to keep in touch and keep connected to BPL.